This is lecture two of module five. This is still looking at the shoulder complex, but we're going to look at joint movement. So the glenohumeral joint here, the relationship of the head of the humerus into the glenoid fossa, is a third degree joint, and so it has movement in all three planes. You can see that it does flexion and extension, ab and abduction, and internal external rotation. Keep in mind, we're just looking at the glenohumeral joint here, the shoulder, and we'll be looking at the shoulder complex as part of that that relationship. So shoulder flexion with the arm coming forward over your head like you're asking a question, then extension coming back down or reaching behind you. You have abduction, so looking at abduction in the frontal plane, the arm coming away from midline. Adduction, the arm coming towards midline. And then don't forget that we have horizontal AB and adduction. So horizontal abduction moving back into the transverse plane, and the horizontal adduction moving forward in the transverse plane. Internal and external rotation. So you have about 180 degrees, both with abduction and flexion. You can kind of see the available range of motion, and about 90-90 internal, external, depending upon what kind of athlete you are. This shows abduction and adduction, and then you can see shoulder flexion and extension. What's not depicted here in the cardinal plane is a horizontal ab and abduction, but you can kind of see in this image here that the arm going forward for flexion is up, coming up, but if you look at the superior view, you can see it coming towards midline. It's the same as horizontal adduction. And same thing here with extension. When the arm's coming back in the sagittal plane for extension, if this arm was out to the side and it moved in this direction, you'd be getting horizontal abduction. The reason I take the time to kind of say this is that when we get to the muscular analysis for next lecture, when we look at these terms of abduction and adduction, they are not the same when we talk about horizontal abduction and adduction. So when we look at the muscular responsibility for shoulder abduction, it is probably close to the opposite of the muscles that are involved in horizontal abduction. And the same goes for adduction. They are opposite of the muscles that are for horizontal adduction and more on the other aspect. So when we look at abduction and adduction, they themselves are independent. That's vertical or frontal plane movement. But when you look at muscular responsibility, and I'll remind you when we talk about this in the next lecture, that the muscles that are involved in flexion are nearly the same as the muscles that are involved in horizontal adduction. And the muscles that are involved in extension are the same as the muscles in horizontal abduction. So the movements are different. This is happening in the sagittal plane. Horizontal ab and abduction is happening in the transverse plane, but the muscular responsibility for horizontal adduction and flexion are the same. So that's the relationship you want to make. You do not want to associate horizontal ab and abduction with the standard or vertical frontal plane ab and abduction. You'll see a lot of textbooks have this circumduction for the hip and for the arm. It just shows that you can move in this conical type movement, combination of all the movements, so that just to depict that it's a third degree joint, ball and socket joint. The one thing that we kind of touched a little bit in the last unit was the angle of the scapula and the way the humerus works. And keep in mind that for optimal joint stability, you want to have maximal congruency between the scapula and the rib cage, and you want to have maximal congruency between the head of the humerus and the glenoid fossa. And so that angle of maximal congruency is about 30 degrees from the frontal plane. So here's your sagittal plane, here's your frontal plane. We're looking down in a transverse plane aspect. The arm is out to the side a little bit. The relationship is where the humerus goes, the scapula follows, and it's trying to maintain that nice tight connection so that there's maximal stability. And so all the movements that we just talked about here with like flexion, extension, ab and abduction, we looked at the humerus moving relative to the scapula, but in reality, the entire complex is moving. So the scapula is always adjusting itself, so it has maximal relationship between the head of the humerus and the glenoid fossa. I had asked you guys to kind of take a look at scapulohumeral rhythm, and we're going to talk about it here, but this is basically what you're seeing here, is that for every degree of movement that the humerus is moving from the scapula is also kind of following suit to make sure that it is maximally congruent between the these two surfaces here. So where the humerus goes, the scapula follows. So when we look at this flexion, extension, ab and abduction, it's not just the humerus that's moving, it's the humeral scapular relationship that is moving. So for every arm movement, you're going to get scapular abduction or protraction, retraction, elevation, depression, upward rotation, or downward rotation. So this is all movement of the scapular thoracic joint. Remember, that's not a true joint, it's just the scapula moving. And you know, we can observe the scapula moving on the rib cage in the elevation, depression, coming forward, coming back, and protraction, retraction, and then this downward rotation where the glenoid fossa for downward rotation ends up pointing downwards, or for upward rotation where the glenoid fossa ends up pointing upwards. Oops. So here's the depiction of elevation, depression, so the shrugging of the shoulder and coming back down, the shoulder blades coming back in retraction, like pinching your shoulder blades back towards the spine or going forward, or raising your arm over your side or coming down. And you can kind of see that here, the relationship here with the humerus for elevation or being pulled down, depression, retraction, protraction, upward rotation, and downward rotation. Now, all of this movement of the scapular thoracic joint is actually happening here at the AC and the SC joint, as I talked about in the last lecture. But you can see that the axis of rotation is actually here and not here, but it's hard to see what's happening at the clavicle or what's happening at the spine of the scapula. So we describe that movement based on what we're seeing happening at the scapula. So this is an anterior view, and you can see that you're getting either elevation or depression, retraction or protraction. Now, I'm just sharing the clavicle and the AC and SC joints just for reference. When we analyze movement, we're going to always be talking in terms of, these movements here. So we'll never be talking about AC elevation or clavicular depression or anything of that aspect. From a clinical aspect, like if you get into more advanced like chiropractic or physical therapy, there are interventions that happen at the clavicle, but the majority of intervention is happening at the scapular thoracic joint. That is the main focus. But what you'll see is that all of these scapular movements of elevation, depression are combination movements of the SC joint and the AC joint working in concert to produce those scapular movements. So if I just shrug my shoulder, what you're seeing here happening, so I'm just looking at this scapula going straight up, that is a combination of SC joint elevation, so the clavicle is elevating, and then a downward rotation of the scapula to keep it nice and level in that plane. If we were to look at upward rotation, we would see that the difference between the shrug and the SC joint is actually doing the exact same thing. So if I look at the SC joint in a shrug, and I look at it in elevation, exactly the same, what differs is the AC joint. This, it was doing downward rotation, and this was doing upward rotation. And the same thing we see with protraction and retraction, that any movement of the scapula is really happening because of the bony connection between the AC joint and the SC joint. Again, just for reference, just for appreciation, that the only bony contact at the scapula and everything connected to the arm is coming in through the clavicular components into the sternum. So again, a rehash of this image showing that the scapula has a certain angle onto the thorax, and at the head of the humerus has a certain angle related to that angle, and so about 30 degrees is that optimal plane of movement. Now remember, when we do the elevation, depression of the scapula, the retraction, protraction, again, this is all review from earlier in the semester, that the scapula does not really move in isolation. You might be able to move that in isolation when you're trying to do certain exercises. So if you're trying to do a shrug, you might just come straight up, your shoulders come up. But in reality, the scapula, all it's trying to do is maintain a solid connection to the thorax. And the reason why it's trying to do that is to stabilize and to maximize the contact surface between the head of the humerus and that scapula, the glenoid fossa. So what's happening here is that as the arm moves, and so if you lift your arm over your head, reach back behind you, go to scratch your back, reach into your back pocket, undo your shirt, brush your teeth, whatever functional task you're doing with your hand, that involves the hand moving, the arm following to support that, and so the shoulder is going to move to accommodate that new position. So really, the scapula is following over a curved surface here, and so you're not really moving in these cardinal planes. It's either going up over the hill, right, and the hill being the thoracic spine and the rib cage, or it's coming back down and down and back. So it's really doing a combination of upward rotation, protraction, and elevation when the humerus is, when your arm's going forward or reaching out in front of you or lifting up, or if you're coming back and down, like let's say a pull down or reaching back behind you or giving someone an elbow or a nudge or whatever you may be doing, your scapula is really coming down and back. And so the next slide is really meant for you to write this down or have this as a snapshot so you can see the relationship of what shoulder movements, so in instance here, shoulder flexion or abduction, internal rotation, typically are related with these scapular movements. And I don't want to say 100% of the time, but like 99% of the time, because there'll always be that one or two cases where you have some weird movement. But for the most part, when you are lifting your arm up over your head, either out to the side or forward, or you're doing internal rotation, your scapula is doing some level of all three of these movements. And then the opposite, so when you're doing extension or adduction, so reaching back behind you, pushing your arm into your side, you're getting some of these movements. So if you just take your arm right now and bend your elbow 90 degrees and do internal rotation and try to internally rotate as far as you can, you will notice that your shoulder blade, your whole scapula actually comes forward a little bit and up. It does a little bit of protraction and elevation. And if you sit there and you do like external rotation, so turn your arm all the way to your side, you'll feel your scapula kind of come down and back and in. So you're doing a little bit of retraction, downward rotation, and depression. The next image kind of depicts that. And you can see some of the muscles that are involved in that. But the up and over, right, arm going up to the side, whether it's flexion, abduction, or horizontal adduction, flexion, horizontal adduction, the same, or abduction in the frontal plane, the scapula is coming up and over the rib cage or the hill. And then if your arm's coming down and back, it's doing this downward rotation. So that's how we're going to look at the muscles in terms of these groups. And you'll see that the muscles are pretty consistent, whether you're doing elevation, upward rotation, or retraction, they're similar muscle components. So the next slide here is looking at this synchronous movement that happens. And when you lift your arm up over your head, which we do a lot in our sport activities or just in day-to-day activities, there's a sequence that's expected. And everyone's slightly different, but for the most part, the phase of lifting your arm over your head, which is referred to as humeral elevation, so it's not necessarily referred to as abduction or flexion. You know, if you were to look at the end position of full shoulder flexion and the end position of full shoulder abduction, the end position is exactly the same. It's your arm straight up over your head. If you were to see a before and after picture, you wouldn't be able to tell whether you flex to get into that position or abduct to get in that position. The initiation is slightly different for in phase one, but the phase two, phase three, whether you're lifting your arm up forward in a flexion or off to the side, that's why it's referred to as just humeral elevation and not necessarily flexion and abduction. But you can see here that the total range of motion is 180 degrees. 120 of that, so two-thirds of that, is coming from the glenohumeral joint, and one-third, 60 degrees, is coming from the scapulothoracic joint. So you get a total 180 degrees, but two-thirds coming from here and one-third coming from there. It happens in phases, so it's not like this is moving the whole time. Your first 5 degrees of movement is exclusively just glenohumeral movement, and that's initiated by the supraspinatus. We'll talk about why in the muscle lecture, but just keep in mind that the supraspinatus is an abductor, and without the abductor, the deltoid would not be able to effectively do elevation to the side. So initiated by the supraspinatus in the first 30 degrees, phase one is glenohumeral movement. And then phase two, you start to get scapular movement. And then phase three, it's back to return to the humeral movement and the whole complex lifts. So this is just showing total range of motion. The next slide here kind of shows which phase and what's actually happening. So again, the text here on the right is the same. But you can see that 60 degrees is coming from here, 120 from there. And you can see the individual components here. But On a testing aspect, don't worry about the specific details, but I would know that you get 180 degrees of movement with a 2-to-1 ratio, so 2/3 coming from there and 1/3 coming from there. And that's it really for movement. The biggest takeaway is understanding the cardinal planes, flexion, sagittal plane movements and so forth, really appreciating the horizontal adduction, abduction relationship to flexion and extension. And then that wherever the humerus goes, the scapula goes. And where we're going to be moving here next is looking at the muscular responsibilities for how this scapular thoracic joint is moving to support the humerus. And so we'll go through these six main muscles of the shoulder girdle complex, and then we'll break it down into your cardinal movements, right? Elevation, depression, retraction, protraction, upward and downward rotation, all at the time realizing that we are doing all three of these combo movements generally at the same time. So that's it for this particular lecture. Make sure you review chapters 4 and 5 for the movement aspect, particularly give special attention to the scapulohumeral rhythm and really appreciating that relationship between the humerus and the scapula.